You're listening to highlights from The David Feldman Show, heard nationwide on Pacifica Radio, or as a podcast on iTunes, Stitcher, and now YouTube. Please subscribe to this channel. For more information, go to davidfeldmanshow.com. Thank you for listening.
The David Feldman Radio program is made possible by listeners like you. You sad, pathetic humps.
Donald Trump has been in office since January and has passed not one single piece of major legislation. Some would suggest the only thing he has accomplished is getting Neil Gorsuch on the Supreme Court to replace the seat left vacant by the death of Antonin Scalia. This month, a raft of decisions came down from the Supreme Court on everything from the travel ban, gun rights, gerrymandering. So how conservative, how much of a textualist is Neil Gorsuch turning out to be? For more on this, we are joined by constitutional law professor Corey Brettschneider, whose piece in Tuesday's New York Times is entitled, "Your Travel Ban Isn't Safe Yet, Mr. Trump." Welcome, Corey Brettschneider.
Thank you, David. Always a pleasure to speak with you.
Yes, I woke up Tuesday morning and I read your piece in the New York Times. You've had a couple of pieces in the New York Times, and I understand today you were on the BBC.
Yes, just about an hour ago I came back from talking about Donald Trump, the travel ban, and that New York Times piece that you mentioned.
Yeah. Hey, I want to talk about July 4th and the Declaration of Independence, the Constitution, the Emoluments Clause, and the travel ban, all these things. Do you mind if I just take care of a little business here before we start?
Not at all.
Okay. Again, I think it's great that you're writing for the New York Times.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Thank you.
One of the things I asked you when you write an amicus brief or for the New York Times, I don't think it's asking too much for you to run it by me first before you send it to the New York Times.
So you think we should have a kind of permission system?
No. I don't have exclusivity. That's not something I would ever do with you. I believe everybody.
Just let you give you a heads up that I'm doing this.
I'd like to know what you're writing, because it does reflect on the show. Just I have this kind of
you want to vet it to make sure it's not too dirty or that it's going to degrade your show in any way.
That's all I'm asking.
Right.
Just
not be embarrassed.
That's all I'm asking. Just run it by me. Again, I'm happy. I'm not saying you need my permission to write an amicus brief or write for the New York Times. I don't own you.
But what you're saying is that your standards are just a little tighter than the New York Times. Is that right?
A little
or the BBC.
A little consideration. I don't want to wake up Tuesday morning, open up the New York Times, and see that you have written an op-ed piece without my knowing about this.
Right.
It makes.
Are you worried there might be bad jokes in there, or that the facts might be wrong, or it won't be copy edited well? What's the?
All of the above.
Okay.
By the way, I don't have a pimp mentality. A couple of people have accused me of acting like a pimp and trying to control my guests. That's not where I'm coming from.
Right.
I just want consideration. And it's not about loyalty. I'm not paranoid. Let's move on. Again, I think I've been very good to you.
You have been.
I've given you a lot.
Known each other a long time.
We've known each other for 3 months. And anyway, the article was great.
Thank you.
It was really great.
It's very frustrating, you know. I mean, when he was a candidate, there was a lot of – he's spinning constantly, and there was a lot of counterspin. Now he's the president of the United States, so when he tweets out that he won his travel ban case 9-0, which is basically what he did, people start believing it.
But we'll get to the travel ban in a second.
Okay.
I have a serious question.
Sure.
I'm making fun of the booking wars that go on in show business. I'm being absolutely serious here. There was a time when if you were a guest on The Tonight Show, you weren't allowed on Letterman.
Okay.
And it was like racketeering. And it still sometimes goes on where they say, well, I want you first. And if you don't do my show first, then you can't go promote your product. Mm. You know, if you go do Kelly and Ryan, then you can't come on my show. And I just experienced this on one of the most minor league levels ever with somebody, and I couldn't believe it. I went, yeah. Really? Are you petty? Are you that petty? Are there racketeering laws that prevent these kind of things?
Well, I mean, you can have an exclusive contract, so I'm sure, you know, a lot of the commentators on television are supposed to just comment for one outlet. I don't think that's an antitrust violation. I think that's just an exclusive contract, the same way that some jobs you're not allowed to moonlight.
Mm-hmm.
So no, I don't think you've got a case there. By the way, if Mark Maron asked me to be on his podcast and he had a requirement that I not do yours for a while,
I would tell you to do Mark Maron.
Or would you tell me?
I would tell you to do Mark Maron.
Because that was my inclination.
Uh-huh. Absolutely. We'll get to your article in a second. There is this pimp-like mentality among people where it's not about commerce. It's about control and power, the intoxication of being able to have somebody bend to your will and make somebody do something that they don't want to do, but you're just more powerful. That's what I've noticed amongst...
Well, what was your thing? What was it? What was
it was so petty. It was not about business. It was about, can I control somebody? It was about actually a guest on the show. And it was somebody who used to be important and no longer is. And he's trying to jumpstart his career again. And he told somebody that you're not allowed to do David's show. You can either do mine. And I'm thinking, really? There's a booking war between me and this loser? Are you that And it's somebody who's from that generation where they get off controlling other humans more than they do just making money and doing good work. So anyway...
Seems silly.
Yeah. That being said, again, please, when you're going to write for the New York Times, clear it with me.
Oh, well. Yeah. Any jokes that I'm going to put in there, definitely I'll clear all the jokes that are in my next piece.
It was great. And it's difficult to cover this topic because it is the travel ban. And the first question I want to ask you is millions of Americans right now are in fear of losing their health care. The CBO just said in 10 years, if this health care bill gets passed, 25 million more Americans will be without health insurance. Why should anybody care about the travel ban?
You know, I think it's all part of a piece that if you take any of these things individually that Trump is doing, the assault on health care, the travel ban, the assault on sanctuary cities, the threat to revoke all of their federal funds, you could say that about any one of these things. You know, what's the big deal? This is something that other people have done, or what's the consequence when this other thing in the world is happening? But to me, the real story of the last 6 months and the campaign is that it all amounts to a really worrying ideology, and it's an ideology of nationalism. Nationalism mixed with a kind of corporate, not just greed, but graft and theft. And that's all tied up, I think, in each one of these pieces. And so it's important to not just fight on one front, but to fight on multiple fronts and to not stop.
I know a lot of people right now who are overwhelmed. The New York Times published a full-page article listing Donald Trump's lies.
Right.
And part of authoritarianism is inundating the citizenry with so much they can't process it all. It's just complete confusion. And they're succeeding in many ways. As the holiday is approaching, so many of us, it's enough already. I can't take it. I'm curious. You have been consistent on the travel ban. I'm going to compliment you. And you're pretty, I mean, you're almost as knowledgeable as I am on this stuff. You have remained laser focused on the travel ban. And before we get to that, can you speak to the importance of citizens finding their issue and staying on it? Did you make a decision in January that you were going to focus on one specific thing and not let up?
I wrote a piece maybe around the time that we met in July when it was still the campaign called Trump versus the Constitution. And what it did was it went clause by clause and it outlined how each one of his proposals and statements led head on into a constitutional provision. It was sort of like a pocket constitution annotated with Trump's proposals. And so I was just waiting. You know, I had studied basically each of these, really had a good sense of the arguments, how they could be defeated in court, and, you know, what was he going to do first? So if he had focused on torture, I think I would have been working on that. But he proposed this really, to my mind, outrageous and lacking in any rationale aside from prejudice travel ban. And so that was the one that I grabbed. But, I mean, I was focused on the threat that he poses to our system as a whole. And to me, this is just one example of that. And it's a very clear way, a successful way, I should say, too. It's worked so far, pushing back against him. And it's rooted, importantly, it's not an ad hoc policy. It's rooted in the president, but really Steve Bannon, his advisors, nationalism, that by a lot of the accounts that are coming out of the White House, is he is the driving force. And, you know, nationalism, white nationalism, whatever you want to call it, is not an American tradition. It's inconsistent with our constitutional system. And this is sort of the epitome of that kind of view. And that's why I'm so focused on it.
For our listeners, one of the things that I'm trying to accomplish with this show is not to overwhelm the listeners, to give them information, important facts, and then have them act on it. And I mean like a minute a day. They don't have to dedicate their entire life. And as you're talking, one of the things that occurred to me is the power of one, focusing on one specific thing. Your strength is the Constitution. So it's not easy, but it's convenient for you to get involved right now because this is your expertise. Everybody has their own specific knowledge, right? So would you, to be a good citizen, you should pay attention to everything, but then figure out what your singular strength is and use that to destroy Trump.
Yes. I mean, I think, look, you got to figure out every day, what can I do to stop this? And that's going to be different, obviously, for different people, depending on their talents. Some people it's constitutional law, other people it's policy, some people it's art, some people it's designing logos, some people it's comedy and satire. And it's one reason why I personally love doing the show is because I think a lot of the people you have on and you yourself are contributing in a huge way. I mean, that's how people pay attention and how we fight back. And so comedy has been no small part. I mean, we're talking about this in a serious way, but, you know, it's the truth that the plethora of shows that are out there, the new Daily Show with Trevor Noah, all of these things are really a way of fighting back. And, you know, for different people, right, the strengths will be different.
I think we should continue with some self-aggrandizement and talk about the importance of comedy.
Yeah.
Because when you look at the state of the country and the rise of political satire, obviously it's done so much to move the ball forward. I disagree with you about political satire. That's another conversation.
I mean, that's interesting that you're pushing back against that part because it serves your interest to try to promote it. But I don't see how there's any way to dispute it. I mean, look, during the Bush administration, too, that the people who really were able to galvanize opposition, I think, you know, one way to do it, and it's a way of pulling truth out, or Samantha Bee, I mean, they're just a long list. Is people who are just seeing the absurdity for what it is and making it just a little clearer for people.
Well, we whitewash history, and that is my next question. We're going to get to the travel ban in a second. Mm-hmm. I think we tend to look back and say, well, we survived. We survived the George W. Bush years. The system works. Tell that to the millions of Americans who lost their homes and their jobs because he crashed the economy. Tell that to the millions of Iraqis who are dead now, and the vets who can't walk, who are dead, who are struggling just to get their prescriptions filled over to VA hospital because George Bush gave tax cuts to the wealthy on the backs of the middle class and our soldiers. I don't necessarily believe we survived Nixon, Vietnam, Reagan, and George W. Bush. That's the narrative that we like. The system works. Which brings me to my question. We're coming up on the July 4th weekend. That's when we declared our independence from the British. I'm being serious here. I'm an Anglophile. Would we have been better off, African Americans might have been better off, had we stayed with the British and gone with a parliamentary system instead of this blueprint we have now that we're working off that I don't think can accommodate the internet and special interests.
When you have a constitutional crisis, as we are, I think, in the midst of, with a president who is continually assaulting the Constitution, it makes sense to try to reconsider the system as a whole. Now, you know, Calexit is one example of that. Talking about parliamentary systems or a constitutional convention would be another. I've got a different angle. I'll tell you what it is. It's something that I'm trying to really work on, and that's to really think hard about the presidency. During the Obama administration, it became very common to say, you know what, the presidency really is virtually unlimited. There is a kind of plenary power in certain matters, or absolute power. There's prerogative power, which is another way of talking about the president's absolute power. And this sort of Madisonian story that there are all sorts of checks and balances, and Congress has a role, and we have a quasi-parliamentary system, and that Congress makes law and the president executes it, that those are all sort of quaint and old-fashioned. And really, I mean, some people even said Carl Schmitt, the sort of theorist of Weimar and Nazi Germany, who talked about the importance of presidents making decisions unbound by law, that even that might be a model. And to me, that's wrong. You know, that's really what this is showing us, that we were too lenient during the Obama administration in thinking about the president's power, and that we have to start going back, not to reconsider what the founders did, but to basically return to the founding idea of a limited presidency. And the president, according to our Constitution, is limited in all sorts of ways, including by the Bill of Rights, and including by the idea that the president executes and doesn't make law. So that's sort of my thing, is this July 4th, I'm kind of reconsidering the way that we've let the presidency get away from us, and thinking about how it needs to be constrained in the way that Madison thought it should be.
And maybe we're seeing that right now.
Yeah. I mean, you know, one thing people used to say about Nixon, I'm a little bit younger than you, maybe a lot younger than you.
Huh?
Good deal younger. We won't go into math. But I didn't live through the Nixon presidency the way that you did. And I think a lot of people in my generation think that was a weird hiccup of history. During Obama. It wasn't going to happen again. And we don't have to worry about it. We don't want to think about the presidency or about the Constitution around this bizarre, weird example that happened. And, you know, Woodward and Bernstein defeated this guy. And what's the big deal? And now I think we're seeing this isn't necessarily a blip. There is something very dangerous in the office of the president if it is an office that's unconstrained. Now, it's not rightly thought that way. And that's another reason why the travel ban to me is fundamental, that it's not just about this case. It's about this idea of a president who is not above the law.
The Nixon administration sent E. Howard Hunt and G. Gordon Liddy into the Democratic headquarters to tap their phones and get information.
Right.
Which is exactly what Putin was doing to the DNC in 2016. That's similar.
Yeah.
The other thing that nobody talks about, Mark Felt was Deep Throat.
Mm.
And he was second in command over at the FBI.
Mm.
That's the similarity.
That's interesting. Yeah.
That Nixon was brought down by the deep dark state. The same way Donald Trump is complaining that the deep dark state is bringing him down. Our founding fathers never factored in a deep dark state.
No, they didn't. I have a friend named, I'll just mention his name, Jeff Howard, and who teaches at University of London. He said to me, what some people call the deep state, I call it committed civil service. And so to me, you know, that's the way of describing what happened in both cases, that the FBI is, they see themselves as law enforcement, and they're not going to do things that are above the law, at least in, I mean, that's not always been true, of course.
Mark Felt, Deep Throat, was pardoned, I believe, by Reagan, because after Watergate, he was breaking into the homes of Black Panthers without a warrant.
Oh, I didn't know that.
Yeah, he was
up to no good, too.
He was up to no good. Mark.
So what was his motivation for doing what he did during Nixon? I mean, I think Comey's, I don't know, maybe I'm naive, but I think it's somewhat pure that he's just trying to tell the truth about what this sort of crazy thing that happened to him. What is Felt's, what was his obligation? Was he devoted, wasn't that he was devoted to the rule of law? It sounds like it was something else.
Well, Mark Felt was a white male who was at one point second in command over at the FBI, especially after J. Edgar Hoover died. Mm. He was pretty important. While he was sneaking secrets to Woodward and Bernstein, he was authorizing the illegal break-ins of quote-unquote revolutionaries like the Black Panthers and the Weather Underground without a warrant. And he got busted, and he had to be pardoned. I think he ended up getting pardoned by Reagan. What is his motivation? Yeah. I think he thinks he loves the country, but I'm also sure that if he's second in command over at the FBI, he's ambitious and a divisive figure within the organization, wanting to rise up to the top. He probably wanted Nixon to go down for reasons that we couldn't possibly understand.
Yeah.
But was threatened by G. Gordon Liddy and E. Howard Hunt, the Cubans who were taking over at, Dan Rather called it, the Palace Guard. Nixon was building up his own Gestapo, essentially.
Yeah.
Well, Mark felt was threatened by that.
Yeah. I mean, I get maybe a way to put it, just to sort of reflect on our discussion, is that nobody's motives are pure. There, people are ambitious, especially people at this level. And even people who have done, I mean, it sounds like in Felt's case, I'm learning this for the first time, but some pretty heinous stuff, might have a moment where they say, you know what, this is frightening for the country. The president of the United States is ordering a break-in of a hotel and trying to get information about the Democratic Party. And in this case, there's an accusation anyway that at least people close to the president of the United States were colluding with a foreign government to try to influence the election. These are major, major crimes by people at the highest levels of government. So even people, I think, in the civil service who have done things that are not pure by in any way, I mean, they might have a moment where they realize that this is just beyond them.
When you talk about the CIA and
the
FBI, I think of as civil servants. I think, you know, J. Edgar Hoover was a horrible, horrible person.
Right.
His name should be taken off the new FBI building that Jared Kushner's family might be building for us. I think he was horrible, but they are kind of clean. They have turned out to be almost impenetrable. I think Comey's motivations are pure, but how pure is the CIA? Where's the transparency with the CIA? Yeah.
Well, it might be that that term deep state, you know, is used now for a variety of purposes. If what it means is that there are aspects of the government and the national security state, for instance, that are sort of beyond the law and have their own agenda, well, that's not something I want to defend. But if it's the, you know, president or his ally saying these people who are standing up to me, who are leaking or who are, you know, trying to get the truth out about what happened in the Russia investigation and in the supposed collusion, in those instances, those people don't strike me as, you know, nefarious agents. They're people who are part of the federal government and doing their job and trying to, what, not be implicated in things that are illegal. That's true of, I think, people in the FBI who are fighting back, including Comey. It was true early on in the transition when the acting attorney general said she wasn't going to implement this policy that became the travel ban. So I guess we have to just distinguish between not just motives, but who we're talking about.
Yeah, and we'll move on to the travel ban. I just was reminded of something about something about Watergate.
I mean, I'm interested, you know, too, I should say, not just in that case, I've been focusing on it, but on this broad theme that we're talking about, which is limits on the presidency. And in, at that time that I know you, you know well because you lived through it and it sounds like it was a big part of your political awakening, there was a lot of time after Nixon where people were talking about the need to structure the federal government in a way that allowed other institutions to function. And that's what I'm starting to write about and think about is we need to do that again. I think we need to have a series of books and reflections on the limits of this very dangerous office, the office of the president.
The deep, dark state cherry picks their outrages. The complaint that Nixon had was Kennedy was far worse. Johnson was far worse. You're bullying me. All I did was break in to the DNC and try to cover it up. If you ever found out what was going on with Kennedy, you guys would celebrate November 22nd, 1963. And what happened after Watergate were the church hearings. the assassination hearings in Congress. Once the Church hearings, Senator Church held these hearings about the CIA, and we found out things after Watergate that Kennedy and Johnson were doing things that were far worse than anything Nixon did to the Democrats. Operation Mongoose, where they're trying to kill Castro, and the Unholy Alliance with Sam Giancana and the Mafia to do their dirty work extrajudicially. The CIA said, well, we can't do this, so we'll get the Mafia to do it. You know, that's why we need transparency. I don't necessarily believe somebody like Mark Felt was pure. I think he was selectively prosecuting Nixon, knowing that there was other stuff going on, but he didn't like Nixon.
We have formal mechanisms that check the president, and we've talked a lot about the judiciary. Congress, of course, is a check, and the hearings that we had recently with Comey. But another fundamental check, maybe the most important, is an informal one, and that's leaking. And those are the leaks that come from people often in the federal civil service. So in a way, it doesn't matter what Felt's biography or motivations were. He was part of this informal but institution, I think, that serves as a really important check on the presidency, and that's leaking. So when I talk about limits on the president, you know, part of it is the Constitution and its official moments, but it also is, I think, you know, very important that we have these leakers. They right. do a public service.
I'll be quiet. I apologize. I'm avoiding the travel ban. One final observation, and please indulge me. Contragate, to me, is where this country went off the rails.
Yeah.
Arthur Lyman was a Wall Street lawyer who was brought down to be the counsel on the Contragate hearings. And one of his famous statements was, I'm here to celebrate the 200th anniversary of the Constitution. That's why I'm here. And it's an honor to serve on this committee and celebrate the separations of powers. Well, they never went after Reagan. But Reagan did during Contragate. Is it the 25th Amendment where they have to get rid of the president because he's senile or can't fulfill the obligations of the office? I think it's the 25th.
Yes, yeah.
They completely let down the Constitution. Arthur Lyman said, I'm here to celebrate the 200th anniversary of the Constitution. And they completely let Reagan slide. They looked into the abyss of the deep, dark state with Contragate, and they blinked. They said, ah, we're not going there. Arthur Lyman, the great Wall Street lawyer who they brought down to be the counsel, he gave an interview about 3 years later and said, you know, we could have impeached Reagan. We had the goods on him. We just didn't think it would be good for the country. We thought he was close to a deal with Gorbachev on nuclear arms. Plus, it would be unseemly to impeach the Republican president who comes in right after Nixon. We can't throw two Republican presidents out of office in a row. So much for celebrating the 200th anniversary of the Constitution.
I think it's important. I'm speaking for myself now to criticize presidents that violate the Constitution, regardless of party. This is self-confession. During the Obama administration, I was a huge fan. The guy is a constitutional lawyer. He was brilliant. He was articulate. He was, to me, a role model, amazing president, maybe one of the best ever.
I agree.
But he did things that I should have been speaking out against. And one example, going back to assassination, is drone attacks. I don't think that it's within the president's power to use drones to assassinate people in foreign governments. And there was a case that was brought of an American citizen who found himself on the drone list and said that his due process rights were violated. And Obama cared enough about this, to his credit, to have his own lawyers look into the constitutionality of the policy. And the courts, frankly, are very reluctant to stop a president, and especially a president on issues of foreign policy. But, you know, that is something that I wish I had spoken out about at the time, because regardless of party, we have to start to set up limits on what it is that this most powerful person in the world can do.
With the Constitution, wouldn't we be better off with a parliamentary system? Isn't a parliamentary system more nimble than what we have?
when the attempted impeachment of the first President Johnson happened after the Civil War, a lot of people said if that would have succeeded in removing the president, that would have been a parliamentary system. Because what it would have meant was that the Congress, for not for high crimes and misdemeanors, but because they didn't like a president's policy, could have just removed him or her. Now, we didn't do that, and I think that would be a mistake to just use impeachment as a sort of no-confidence vote. But I think there's an in-between, the extreme executive power that we have now and a parliamentary system. And that's a more aggressive Congress and more defined judicial limits on what the president can do. That starts to look more like a parliament, but it, you know, we have a tradition, we have a constitution. I don't think we're going to throw it out the window. And it's something that we can do that I think in many ways captures the original meaning of the Constitution, which is maybe more parliamentary would be a way to put it than the current very presidential system that we have now.
What would happen if we had more than two parties? Would that trigger a parliamentary system?
No, we would still have, I think in South America, you still have presidential systems with multiple parties. And, you know, a parliament is defined by legislative supremacy, the idea that parliament really is the sovereign entity and the prime minister, the leader of the government, is beholden to the will of parliament, can be recalled, for instance, if there's a no confidence vote, when majority of parliament goes against him or her. Now, we don't have anything like that set up. We have a presidential system where a president has independent, real power to implement the law. And to go to a parliamentary system would require a convention or a complete rewriting of the Constitution. I guess what I'm suggesting is that what defines parliamentary systems is a strong role for the legislative branch and limits on what the person executing the law can do, the cabinet. And in our system, we've sort of gravitated towards this idea of a pretty weak Congress and a very strong president. And I think that balance has to be reset.
Let me paint this scenario for you. I ran this by Ralph Nader, and he didn't think there was any legitimacy to it. Mm-hmm. And I am name dropping.
Yeah. Do you do a show with Ralph Nader every week for the last decade?
Please, let's stay focused. If there were three or four or five parties, that would affect the Electoral College. That would affect how many votes you get when you run for office. You have to get a...
That's interesting that you're saying if there really were not just the existence of these parties, but that they started to, in presidential elections, do well, then it might basically deny any one party the ability to get the necessary votes to become president. Is that what you're thinking?
Yes, and then it has to go into the House of Representatives.
Yeah, that's interesting. That did happen in the election of 1800, for instance, and that's how Jefferson was elected.
Right.
Yes, I mean, that's
it wasn't Rutherford B. Hayes too, wasn't that?
Mm-hmm.
It was just.
I don't know. I don't know the answer to that.
Either do I.
Okay.
I figured you didn't. I'm teaching my listeners how to talk to somebody like you.
Yeah.
He's not going to know who Rutherford B. He's so into this travel ban.
Thought we were cooperating.
I know. I'm just talking to my listeners for a second.
I see.
Okay? I'm teaching them how to BS. Corey, professor, just let your mind wander for a second. He is so tied up right now in his amicus brief and the Ninth Circuit Court on the travel ban. Rutherford B. He probably knows who Rutherford B. Hayes is. He can only remember so many things. Throw it in his face, confuse him. Now he's staggering. I go in for the kill now. Hi, welcome back, Corey. You still there?
Yes, is this a part where I get to pitch my comedy ideas?
No, I want to go back because I pitched this idea to Ralph and he...
It's interesting.
He confused me because I said, you know, had the Green Party succeeded... I don't know what it says in the Constitution about what you need to become president, but there is a certain number that you need at the Electoral College, right? You have to hit 270,
yes.
Right?
Yeah.
So if you don't hit 270, then it goes into Congress. Well, if it goes into Congress and they're multi-parties, I would think that turns us into a parliamentary system because in order for you to become president, you have to build coalitions. And you're pretty much getting elected president using the Speaker of the House. So the Speaker, for all intents and purposes, becomes the Prime Minister, and the President becomes a figurehead.
Yeah, well, look, it's an interesting idea, and it's, I guess what I would say is it's got an aspect of the parliamentary system, in the same way that a limited presidency is an aspect of it. But is it actually a parliamentary system? No. In a parliamentary system, you can recall the prime minister with a no confidence vote, for instance. If a majority of parliament votes no confidence, that will trigger an election. Or there can be an election called by a prime minister who wants to feels too weak and wants to strengthen his or her power by doing better in a nationwide vote. That wouldn't happen in our system under the Constitution. I'm giving you some credit here, but not full.
Okay, let's say Paul Ryan
had
to forge a coalition among the old Republicans, and then the Tea Party was their own party, and Ryan became speaker because he was able to work out a deal with the Tea Party party and the Republican party. And suppose the Freedom Caucus was their own party. So it's this amalgam of three or four parties. You mean to tell me that the Freedom Caucus and the Tea Party wouldn't be rebelling right now and calling for Paul Ryan's head over the health care bill?
Yeah, it
would be a no confidence vote.
It would be, but the difference, I guess, I'm not really disagreeing with you. I think it's interesting. It would have some aspects of a parliamentary system. But my point is that formally, our Constitution has differences. So you still would have a formal election every 4 years for president. It wouldn't just happen when there was a weakness of a particular president in power. And you would have elections every 2 years, for instance, for the House and so on. We would have a hybrid of things that were parliament-like with in your scenario that you're laying out, but with a constitutional system.
Right. I want to stay on this for a second because this is an idea that has been shot down by...
No, I know. You want to build it back up. You could tell Ralph Nader what I said, that you actually had some good points.
Even if we stick to electing Congress every 2 years, the job of the speaker would always be up for grabs. The job of the prime minister would always be vulnerable.
What defines a prime minister is they are a member of the legislative branch, the parliament, but they also are the chief executive in a way of, I mean, I guess the queen is technically the equivalent.
Or the president. Sometimes they have a president and a prime. France.
Yeah. I was thinking in the, right, at least in the British system, that the prime minister sort of acts in the role of executing the laws as well with the fellow ministers. But in our system, we have still this president that would be there, despite the fact that he or she might be elected by the Congress.
When we hear of the importance of a third party,
nobody
ever pitches this. Nobody ever says why a third party and a fourth party, why we would succeed, how we could keep the Constitution and make it nimble.
Mm-hmm.
Nobody
Would it be more chaotic, though? That's my worry.
We want chaos.
Yeah.
Look at what we have now. We have this sclerotic system that's accomplishing nothing.
What about the suggestion I was trying to make for trying to build your idea rather than get my own? But of
By
using
the way, can we make money off this idea?
No.
We're
in the public good business, not in the money business.
Wait, you mean to tell me like Thomas Jefferson's ancestors don't get a piece of the Declaration of Independence?
It's just that's the president that we're fighting. Is trying to make money off this, meaning the government. That's what we're trying not to do.
Wait, I was at Norman Lear's house 2 months ago. He bought one of the copies of the Declaration of Independence. I think he paid $8 million for it. I'm thinking, God, the Jefferson estate, those kids they don't have to work. You're telling me he doesn't get a piece of this?
I don't think it works that way. I was going to help you make your point in a way you could go back to
Ralph
Nader.
Well, now I'm not interested.
You're really smart.
I'm not interested
now. Victory.
What's the point? Go ahead.
What about here's my way of summing up the smart thing that you said, which is how could we take the constitutional system and turn it into a parliamentary system? One way is to emphasize going back to impeachment. Maybe, there's no requirement that high crimes and misdemeanors really are high crimes and misdemeanors. That mechanism could be used. It's up to the Congress, and it could be used the way that it almost was in the 19th century as a parliamentary system to recall presidents that just basically lack popular will.
Mm-hmm.
That would be a way of doing what you're saying in a kind of simple way, I think, but that would work. Now, I don't know that we want to do that. I think that could create a kind of chaos and instability in the system that would keep us from getting anywhere and would be wrapped up in scandal. But it would be a way of accomplishing, I think, some of what you were getting at.
This is one of our best episodes, but we're being glib and funny, and we're not rolling up our sleeves and doing the work we need to do. But I do what this is more fun. I'm being lazy and playful.
When am I going to pitch my comedy idea?
Please don't yeah. even. I want to talk to you about
the. You don't want to be that clip.
Just stick with your constitution, Professor.
It's really good.
I'm not. You're insulting me by even thinking that you could pitch me an idea for comedy.
It's not really for you. It's for.
The 27th Amendment.
Can he call me? Actually, does he have a show? Yeah.
You talking about, you want to pitch an idea?
Yeah. Does he have a podcast or something where I could get on and give him my idea?
I am a certified.
A huge fan. I mean, huge fan.
I'm a licensed comedy writer. I worked hard to get my comedy.
You go to school for that?
I have a comedy writing license.
Where do you sign up for that?
I made it myself. But that's, they used to have cabaret licenses. In order to be a performer, you needed a cabaret license. Can we reinstate cabaret licenses so that these young comics will
can't
stop?
Come along.
How do we eating?
Began the show by talking about how you're worried about the antitrust violations from the bookers on these shows. But now it looks like you want to engage in anti-competitive behavior yourself.
Okay, you go, you take your wife, you get a babysitter, right? And you say, mm-hmm. Let's go see comedy at Dangerfields. And there's a comic up there who's practicing comedy without a license.
Mm-hmm. I often go to the Comedy Cellar, just for the record.
Do you think it's right? I know for a fact that Rich Voss does mm-hmm. not have a license to perform comedy. Do you feel safe?
Who would grant it?
I would. That's I where see. The money. We have medallions.
No, that's called capture. You know what capture is, right?
No, what is that?
It's the idea that the government supposedly is doing things like granting licenses in a way that's for the common good, but really somebody is benefiting from it, some personal entity like you in your comedy license entity.
I'm just
that's capture.
Okay, listen. let me run this idea past you, okay? In order to perform comedy, you have to buy a medallion.
My idea is really good. I don't have a comedy license. I don't have the time to.
But what about medallions?
I should be able to pitch.
What
about
able to pitch it? What is the point of our doing this if I can't get rich? Listen to me, Professor. Medallions. You need a comedy medallion, like, you know, cab drivers have.
And wait a second. You told me when I asked you if I was going to get paid for this that I was going to be doing a public service, and that's what you were all about. So now I'm starting to think maybe that wasn't true.
Of course it's a public service. Aren't I part
of
the public?
You said that it was rude to ask for money.
It's rude for you to ask for money.
Okay.
So the 27th Amendment, this is how slow the Constitution is. The 27th Amendment was ratified in 1992. It was introduced on September 25th, 1789. It took 202 years. For the 27th Amendment to be ratified. Do you know what the 27th Amendment is?
Everybody has to do with salaries, right?
No, it's everybody must do all their Amazon shopping via the David Feldman Show website.
Okay. I saw that I was supposed to do that, and I'm supposed to send you a note when I buy something.
I'm going to indulge you. You go ahead. You have an idea. You realize how...
I'm going to give you the premise. I think it's a great premise, but okay. Now you've got to help me fill it out.
Okay, before you pitch this premise to me, and I indulge you, do you realize how insulting it is to be talking to David Feldman, a licensed comedy writer? I've had breakfast with Lou Schneider mm-hmm. at Jerry's Deli in the Valley.
Yeah, you told me what he ordered, too.
Yeah.
It was a pastrami, right?
Yeah.
Or corned beef.
Yeah, with the Russian dressing on the side.
Russian dressing, right.
And, you know, we have a nice relationship. I like you. You're smart.
Thank you.
But you really are crossing a line by pitching me an idea.
Do I need an agent before I do this, by the way?
I just think it's presumptuous
to
approach me, David Feldman, a comedy writer who's had lunch with Lou Schneider at least 5 times in the past year, for you to think that you can just talk comedy with me. Do you know the steps one must take to meet with There's the circuit of young comedy writers. You work that, and then
Look,
when you
why do you think I'm doing this show? It's a way of jumping the queue. I want to get my idea to him. I'm not going to get it by calling him.
There's a system in place.
I'm not really a believer in that.
Oh, I no, think, you have to. No. You have to. If you have an idea, you pitch it to me.
It's called capture.
No. If you think after I reject it, then you go to Michael Komen. He's an appeals comedy writer. He may send it back down to me or move it up to. There's a chain of command. Do I have to explain this to you?
Can I just say I am so thrilled to hear about this, that there is a constitutional system for comedy pitching, because I was worried that you're going to reject my idea, maybe out of jealousy. And then I thought, like, there's no Supreme Court to go to, no judicial review.
There
but
is.
Now you say there is.
Of course.
So who do I go to if you
wanna,
reject?
You want to bring it to eventually.
Yeah, he's the president.
But you don't just go before him. And by the way, you don't get to pitch.
Who are you in the system? You're like the
Solicitor General.
The assistant who does the scheduling?
I'm the Solicitor General. In other words,
You argue the case.
I argue against it.
I see. You are the Solicitor. Well, now we're getting a little. Solicitor General argues for the government.
But you're pitching an idea. You're not part
I'm
of the
pitching
government. You're
a
plaintiff.
Okay. Well, you have to hear it before you decide if you're going to argue against it.
I cannot respect.
This is taking a very long time. My God, there's a lot of bureaucracy in this whole comedy profession. I have an idea.
The wheels of comedy turn very slowly, and there's a reason for that, Professor.
Jeez.
We don't.
This is like a scandal, like the Watergate of the comedy pitching.
Comedy is incremental. We want things to move ahead comedically, but slowly and safely. Go ahead. Pitch your silly idea, and I'll tell you why it won't work. Go ahead.
I'm like getting intimidated. So I think that one person that we need
it's
to
been
focus
done already.
On more.
It's been done. I've seen it already.
Jesus.
It's been done. Ernie Kovacs did it. You're so nice. Go ahead.
Oh, now I'm intimidated. I'll never get it out. I just have the premise. You were the one who was going to. I thought it was a partnership.
Hang on. Talk to my audience for a second. Get your pitch ready.
That just makes me feel awkward.
Get your pitch ready. I got to talk to my audience. The balls.
It's like, you've got 50,000 people to whisper to on the side.
The balls on this guy to think that he can come on my show and pitch a comedy idea to me, David Feldman, who was on Evening at the Improv at least 12 times in the 80s. You know what? We recorded this show live to tape. Let him make a fool out of himself. Hey, Corey, are you still there?
And now I'm not going to want to do it.
What?
Now I'm not going to want to. I listened to your ideas about the Constitution and the Parliament. What are your credentials for thinking about the relationship between presidential systems and parliamentary systems? I believe that you're a citizen and that you have the right to say, give an idea, give arguments. I take it seriously. I listen.
Yeah.
And now when they were entering this whole comedy thing, that's like a very elitist world that
well,
I can't even give my premise.
I'm a high priest of comedy. Go ahead.
I know.
Go ahead.
That makes sense. It's not a constitutional system. It's a theocracy.
Pitch to the comedy Ayatollah. Go ahead.
You got to ask me nicely to hear my idea at this stage.
All right. Corey, Professor Brettschneider, I understand you have an idea. Go ahead. Pitch me your comment.
I think I have a pretty good premise.
Okay.
Okay, it comes from an article in Slate, and this is the headline. Steve Bannon was once hired to manage an artificial world of people living under glass before the Trump campaign. And the article is about how Steve Bannon at one point lived in Biosphere 2 for a time in the 1990s. The article talks about this, where they were trying to deal with the crisis of global warming by creating an artificial world in it that had rivers and all sorts of things under glass. And part of what the article reports on is that people didn't really get along with Bannon. He had a lot of feuds. The article says that he called one person a quote-unquote bimbo, and worse. So here's the premise. It's a kind of cartoon, and we're in this biosphere, and Steve Bannon can't get along with anyone. He's harassing people, and at one point he's just rejected by many people and finds himself isolated, and in revenge within Biosphere 2 he decides that he has a great idea, which is to build a wall. And of course, he gets his friend Donald Trump to help him build the wall in the middle of biosphere to this artificial world with the bubble. What do you think? And that's where the wall comes from. Is that something you could do something with? That's the premise, but you've got to make it funny.
Okay. Well, I think it's cute that you had an idea.
Got a political purpose, too. This is somebody who we have to try to, you know.
There is a sliver, a germ, a microscopic germ of an idea there. But your naivete notwithstanding, I can take this tiny microscopic idea, and I will show you how I will build on it. Do you have a pen? Write this down, because I'm going to show you how I'm going to take your idea, because this is my gift, because I've been in Hollywood since before you were born. And I will show you how I can take just like a razor-thin premise and turn it into magnificence. Okay. Now watch. All you've done is let out a little belch.
It's a story by.
But let me show you how I weave my magic. So there's this thing called the biodome, where they put human beings underneath.
Biosphere.
Or the biosphere, the biodome. I call it the biosphere. I think biosphere will sound funnier. It has an F. That's funny. People are living in this biosphere because we're trying to train them to live on another planet. And Steve Bannon, this is true. I don't know if you know this, but Steve Bannon at one time lived in a biosphere to test this out and got into trouble with a woman because he called her a bimbo. And everybody, because he's such a divisive figure, hated Steve Bannon, right? So he decides, you know what? Half the people in my biosphere hate me. I don't want them near me. I'm going to build a wall. I'm going to get Donald Trump. See, now it's political. See what I've done here? I'm tying it into...
You haven't changed one thing.
But you called it a biosphere. You said it was a. You said biodome. I said biosphere.
That's biosphere.
Biosphere. That makes it. That's
read it from the article. Slate.
It's a completely different story. It's completely different.
It's no different.
Biosphere.
We have to go back to that trademark copyright discussion.
What are you talking about? You pitched.
Oh, we have the evidence.
You pitched an idea about.
This tape is recorded.
This is insane.
Subpoena this tape.
This is insane.
Subpoena the tape.
This is insane. You said biodome. I said biosphere.
I knew this is how it works. That's why I asked if I needed an agent.
Corey, can you just not pay attention for a second? I have to talk to my listeners.
Okay.
Obviously, I've stolen this idea from Corey Brettschneider. Now I do Hollywood jiu-jitsu. Watch. Hey, Corey, are you there?
Yes. Thank you for listening to my idea, by the way. I really appreciate
it.
Award-winning listening to my story by.
You didn't have a story. Premise. You didn't have an
my
idea.
Premise.
You didn't have a premise. You had a word. You had a word,
right.
Biodome. I change it to biosphere. It's my idea. My listeners, now watch how
recorded.
I watch the genius. It's recorded? What do you mean by that?
I mean the pitch that I gave you, the exact same one.
You recorded this conversation?
No, you did.
Are you accusing me of recording a conversation? Do you think, what am I, Donald Trump recording you like he recorded Comey? You think I'm that dishonest that I would record all my conversations? What kind of, why would you, see what I'm
are
doing?
Are you saying that this whole thing that we're always talking to each other has not been for a podcast? It's just a way for you to get information about constitutional law. And I've spent for the last 3 months, just all this time just talking to you when you pretended that this was on a podcast?
If you're going to use the F word, I can't talk to you. If you're going to say the F word and spew this kind of horrible, vile vitriol at me, I don't like the tone of your voice.
I'm sorry, sir. Sorry.
Oh, no, you're not supposed to do that. I'm trying to teach my audience. That's the old Hollywood trick. Yeah, the trick is you steal from somebody.
Well, your mom's not going to be happy about this one. She already is worried about the disrespect. But
I know.
Now taking the idea, it's not going to go well for you.
The way you steal an idea is you steal the idea, and then when they come at you, you make it an issue. You make it an issue about their tone of voice.
I got it.
In all seriousness.
Did you really like the idea?
Yeah, I did, actually.
Yeah. Great.
I liked it so much, I'm going to take credit for it.
Can we co-create?
How dare you? How dare you? Didn't Polly Shore did a movie called Bio?
Yeah, but it didn't have the Steve Bannon angle. when you pitch it, that's the, you know, that wasn't, I don't know, if I've actually never seen it. But when you pitch it, it can be white nationalism meets Polly Shore's Bio.
All right, let's quickly. Oh my God,
this one really went off the rails.
It did. Jeez. And you know why? You know what? This is the story of my college career, because I didn't read Jon Stewart Mill like you assigned me, and you had this great article in the New York Times. I have to, before I go, and I'm going to be late for Fugelsang, but let's very quickly do
tell him why you were late. Be sure to tell him why.
Professor Brettschneider wouldn't stop fooling around.
He pitched me this great idea about the biosphere.
All right, let's end. Let's end on a serious note. Let's do our work. So where are we with the travel ban, Professor? And try to keep it serious. Where are we? And you say in the New York Times that it's going to be rejected in October when the Supreme Court considers it.
Donald Trump, as usual, has claimed victory and out of whole cloth really made up a story about how he won his travel ban case in the Supreme Court, as he put it in a tweet, 9-0. And unfortunately, a lot of the national media are following him. So what this piece in the New York Times does, and hopefully others will pick up on it, is really look at what the court did. And what they did was, first of all, say that there is, and this has really been missed by a lot of people, that there's the way they did this, if you read it closely, its indication is that by saying that they're not going to allow for the implementation of the ban for people with bona fide or significant relationships from these countries with people in the United States, what they're saying is that there's a substantial likelihood of success that that claim is going to win in the end when they hear the case in the fall. In other words, they are saying, in this opinion, that it is very likely, substantially likely is the technical way of putting it, that they're going to strike down a huge part of this travel ban. Now, there is a part of the ban that they allowed to take place, and it took place today, and Trump is trying to get as much publicity for it as he can. And that's for people who have no bona fide relationship with people in the United States. That means, for instance, if you don't have any parents, or actually they've said even grandparents, don't qualify as a bona fide relationship, you are now banned from coming into the country if you're in one of the six countries on the list. But I think actually that the court, even though they haven't have allowed that to take effect, in the end, the legal arguments against the whole thing are so strong, and this claim about the substantial likelihood of striking down at least part of the ban all indicate that Trump is going to lose if this thing is still in place in October.
It is being implemented, though, right?
The part that's being implemented that they allowed to be implemented were for people who going to a university, for instance, if you have a sibling or a parent that's in the country. The language that the Supreme Court of the United States used was if you have a bona fide relationship and you're from one of these six countries with somebody in the United States, this ban cannot apply to you. In other words, you could come in if you have a visa anyway. But if you don't, then yes, then they've allowed for it to be implemented for now.
Is there a possibility the ban will be over because eventually Donald J. Trump will figure out what the hell is going on? You know, in his campaign, he called for this ban until he can figure out what the hell is going on. Is there a time limit on the ban?
He says that he wants, I think, 90 days to study it. That's his ostensible reason for the ban, as he puts it sometimes. He wants to figure out what is going on here. Yes, it's time limited from the time it takes place. I think it's 90 days. And then it will expire. Now, he has the ability, it's an executive order, to extend it, to get rid of it sooner. And one thing that is possible that maybe you were alluding to is that he might just decide, you know what, I don't want to deal with this anymore. I'm going to let this thing expire and, you know, I'll pretend that I won back in the spring and nobody will be the wiser. It's been such a disaster for him and such a lesson in how his, and Bannon's, I should say, going back to the earlier discussion, animus towards Islam really has no place in our constitutional culture. And that's why courts have repeatedly struck it down and why the Supreme Court indicated there was a substantial likelihood that it would be struck down, at least with reference to people with a bona fide relationship.
You wrote in your piece for the New York Times The Ninth Circuit Court rejected the ban because it most likely violates an immigration law that prohibits, quote, discriminating on the basis of nationality.
Right.
I thought we could discriminate against people's nationality when it came to immigration. Don't we have quotas on who can come into this country? Wasn't there a time in our history when we'd say, okay, 6% of the immigrants can be from Czechoslovakia, 3% from Haiti? Isn't that how we used to?
There was, and then that, and there was actually a vile Chinese Exclusion Act at one point that prohibited all immigration of Chinese immigrants. But that legislation that the Ninth Circuit is referring to was passed precisely to get rid of that system of national discrimination. That's why the law was passed. That's not a constitutional argument. That's a statutory one, but an equally important one.
Was that passed during the Johnson administration?
There was a law passed, I believe, in the 1960s called the Immigration and Nationality Act that eliminated quotas and also eliminated discrimination based on national origin. And so that's not a constitutional argument. It's a statutory one. And that's what the Ninth Circuit relied on is the text of that law.
There's a great article in The New Yorker by Calvin Trillin about the Immigration Nationality Act of 1965, how it changed food in America. Once everybody from every type of country was allowed into America, suddenly foodies were discovering Kazakhi food, you know, Azerbaijani food. A lot of obesity can be traced to the Immigration Nationality Act of 1960, all this great food. You were saying something about Chinese food? What was?
I did see something that talked about this sort of odd history of Chinese restaurants. This was something that I saw online about there was a strange way that could avoid the discrimination against Chinese immigrants by having a restaurant. And so the argument anyway was that the increase in the number of Chinese restaurants that you see in the 20th century, they grow very large, was tied in some way to avoiding this discrimination. So, you know, I mean, this is just a small way, of course, that we can think about the vast array of cultures that make up the United States is through food. It's a very small way, and, you know, certainly not the only way. It also has an odd relationship to the country's bigotry. But, I mean, I don't know. It sort of just goes to the fundamental point, which is that this administration doesn't appreciate America in the way that the rest of us do. They think it's ethnic history of, I think, unfortunately, not devoted to pluralism, not devoted to people coming from around the world. And that's just a very different America than the one that I think you and I value and see every day.
I'll talk to you next week.
Bye.
You're listening to Highlights from The David Feldman Show, heard nationwide on Pacifica Radio, or as a podcast on iTunes, Stitcher, and now YouTube. Please subscribe to this channel. For more information, go to davidfeldmanshow.com. Thank you for listening.
The David Feldman Radio Program is made possible by listeners like you. You sad, pathetic humps.